Oh, that's fantastic, Nick. That's brilliant. I'll sort of probably start with you. Just maybe sort of bring it back to that analysis point, and there's clearly a lot of analysis going into the players, not only technically and tactically, but also the sort of the biomechanics as well. I just wondered, at what point do you get involved with that, or is it sort of a lot of the analysis is coming on from the head coaches
With
and
bio.
that analytics team, and then they come to you with, okay, Nate, we want you to take a look at this, and then you have to start forming your way of working.
It's basically, I can give you an insight of what it's like at my club. It's basically, we have like a big office, and it's one of these things that all of these things would be discussed the entire time. It's not like the coach comes to you and gives you an objective. You're in the process the entire time, so you're constantly in analysis and talking about what you're going to be doing next. So I wouldn't really say it's one of those things that somebody comes to you and says, "Hey, fix this."
Okay, that's cool. Yeah, just want to, yeah, clear if you're actually in and part of the process, or you're someone they just come to with a solution. So when you're in that process, I mean, obviously some of the players you've seen, I don't know if you could pick out one example, but what was the analysis process that goes on? Is there a, how is that problem identified, is basically what I'm getting at.
How is the problem identified? Well, it basically just goes down to looking at it depends on what position you're talking about. If you're talking about offensive players, then it basically just came down to looking at each individual player and finding out where does he arrive at most in the box, and can he improve then his percentage on first hitting the target from that box. But to go back to your question, I mean, it just comes down to, there's things that the coach sees that he goes together with his staff that he, there's situations where he says, "Here, we could have scored a goal, but nobody else sees it that way. And the reason we could have scored the goal is because if the number eight would have taken the right first touch here forwards, he could have played this ball into the path of the striker. We could have scored." It's a very difficult question because it's also subjective. If that makes sense.
I get a feel that it kind of begins with the questions with the head coach. Obviously, has a very deep understanding of it, and he's asking questions of why is this that not happening.
Exactly.
Sort of slapping me as an analyst, is that pretty much how you are looking at the game and individual players and asking why is X, Y, and Z not happening?
Well, I also agree, this is not very easy topic. First of all, maybe I will repeat myself, but the key point is the identity of the player. But we need to consider the team tactics as well, because this is how the player is being evaluated by the coaches and by the coaching staff. To make these questions accurate in the relation to the player, we both need to have a clear idea without this topic, like the team tactics. And mostly if I ask why is not A, why is not B happening, I already give the answer to the player what have been expected from him. I don't want it. I would rather leave the open question for him. If this is something you want to achieve, or there's something else you wanted to achieve, how could you guide your actions, your decision to achieve that goal? And if not, or if yes, basing on which points of reference you made your decision. This is something very close of what Marcel said. This is, we need to consider dynamics. This in football, the space. If you have a space, you have time. If you have no space, you have no time. But basing to execute your decisions, you need to consider the space, positioning of the teammate, positioning of the opponent. You are acting basing in these points of reference in your surroundings. And then I focus mostly about if player provided for himself enough information to execute his decisions. This is what I ask mostly when we analyze. Because if I ask why this didn't happen, why did that happen? I guide the player to already some mind pattern. and then analysis is just a common, okay, you see, I agree. Do you agree? I agree. Great. Analysis is done. Then we can make 50 analyses like this, reaching no goal or making no progression.
Hmm. And Marcel, in order to build on that, or even to draw it back a little bit more, we seem to get the idea of understanding how we're communicating a problem with a player. But first of all, as a coach, you have to identify it before you can then begin these conversations with a coach, seeing that, right, the player is doing something in a certain way, which maybe is not the ideal. Marcel?
A mute. You hear me?
Right. Yes.
Well, first of all, it's very important to realize that still in football, a lot of those things are based on an opinion. An opinion on itself is already subjective. And that's what I tried to show. And I realize also this framework is not that body, that everybody can directly adapt it. But it is a very objective way to analyze a player, or even, and surely, and that's the most challenge for coaches, to do that in the game situation. So in read also in the training, because in the training, you have the possibility to freeze a situation when you see it. But the game, it's not a coaching sport. Football is a much more complex sport than every other team sport. Other team sports, and I heard that Nate made the example from basketball. It's interesting to look to other sports, yes, and other areas. But in football, you play with your feet. It is 360 degrees. And opponents are able to defend you, but also to attack you. And all those things make it totally different than every other sport. So that makes it much more difficult. And that is a challenge to bring players in more and more in that situation, so that they're going to build references in the unconscious. And when you do it too much isolated, there is also not a stimulus response. So the challenge is to do the same thing and challenge yourself. How can I transport that in the team training, even when there are small groups, and what will be my role? As an example, when the coach is, for example, busy with the what are we going to do on team level, for example, in building up, and now I have some individual players, like the wing backs or full backs, whatever, or the center half or the midfield player. The midfield player has he's scanning. And I heard Nate saying vororiëntering. It's also funny because I introduced vororiëntering in that time in Germany, because they didn't use words for this, because it was also not known. And in England, orientation is one thing, but pre-orientation is something more fine-tuned. So you want to develop a player in that part, or scanning like Slavomir said. Now you want to develop him. So your role as an assistant is then that you can coach him in those situations when it happened. That's the aim. And then you're going to realize, okay, maybe the player makes the right decision of, for example, passing the ball, but the execution of passing is with too less speed or in the wrong direction. Now, the question is now, can we make him better that he passed the ball with more speed? What's the reason for that? Does he have tension in his foot? Now, the question now, do I have to do this isolated, or do I do that in the game situation? And do I use opponents? Now, that's the challenge. Instead, going back to the most simple form. So, and that is the evolution in football, what has to happen. That will take time, but we come to this. Because we are now talking about individual coaching. And as I said, 30 years ago, I started with this to have a provocation in the world. And still, we are busy with this. It's not developed, totally not developed. But we come to this to understand also how players learn, how people learn, how kids learn. You need a stimulus response. And you know, the most people I think on this forum are now that the moment that you explain something, a player will be unconscious and incompetent. The moment that he's going to do it, he will be more conscious, but he's still incompetent. And then you're going to coach him in detail, not by repetition, but in detail, related to where he can improve. And then he will be more competent and conscious. But at the end, you want that he is competent, unconscious. So you have to build a lot of stimulus in his conscious in order that he can put out of unconscious. So, and that will take time, but that will go faster when you're building references that he is coming. When you're driving a car, that's a nice metaphor. So you're driving a car, you have a driving license. You don't go all the time back to the parking and driving half an hour in the parking and then join the traffic where you're communicating with other people in traffic and have to make decisions and execute these decisions with your gear. No, you're going to start directly inside there. So, and you're going to build references, more references, and you're going to make more and better and faster decisions. So that's the challenge. Yeah? That doesn't mean that there is no place for isolated training, but before you do it, you have to do it in the team context and understand football in its complexity. Because like we say, the first touch, what I saw, for example, you can do this. Yeah, it's there's no stimulus. But when there is an opponent, it's much more unpredictable. So when you bring him in that situation, then still you can coach his first touch, but you make it now more in the game context that he learns also to see the unpredictability of the opponent. And based on that, he has to make decisions and execute those. And that's what I meant also before, when you do, like we say, a possession game and you want to improve passing or controlling the ball, yeah, then you can do this. But what happened a lot, two contacts, come on, concentrate, focus, all kinds of general terms, instead of to the point and realizing also that you can make players better within a given fact with opponents. And that is where they will improve much faster and much better. Because interesting part, when you're training isolated, you can coach him and that he has a reference, okay, touching the ball with shooting, for example. And Nate, I saw this goals also from Felix when he played sometimes in the national team, not always, but sometimes. But to bring him in the situations against opponents, for example, where there's more compact, and to have his eyes on the ball instead of the goal. Now, this kind of details, and where do you touch the ball? With your inside lace and this kind of thing. So you can do, isolate, you can do a lot. When I would ask all the coaches, with how many size of 1 foot are you be able to pass a ball or control a ball? Then everybody has 4 or 5. Now, 6 sides of only your foot, you can control and pass a ball. Now you have 2 foot, it's 2 times 6, it's 12. From 12 different directions, so there are 144 possibilities. So, but the main thing is challenge yourself and go in the game situation and simplify that back to the player. That's the most. Then you're building really references, and then you're coming really in the stimulus response patterns. Yeah.
And Slavomir, to bring you in, there's sort of certainly in your presentation, you sort of decide, as with everyone, introduced this idea of what we're doing here. Now we're kind of changing player habits with what you're doing with these sort of interventions. But the key here is like to change the player perspective. So where in your analysis are you deciding that the best way of evolving and helping change this player perspective is either to do it within a one-to-one situation or within a group training aspect?
Well, this, the player, it's by himself, cannot act as an individual, independent person during the game. The same goes with like the technical execution in the collective aspect. It doesn't exist like as an independent factor of the game. The technical execution is always happening in the reference to other players, to space, to opponents, to teammates. But as you mentioned, changing the habits, all the perspective of myself, even of everyone, if you see something with your own eyes, if you understand this context, it brings you one step closer to understand your habits, your decisions that you already made. Because it takes a lot of time to work with it. If we put the technical individual training or physical, then from one performance to another, you can already notice some improvement. you make a bet faster in the 100 meter sprint or anything. But what about the football intelligence? What about your decisions? What about analysis? So this process takes really a lot of long time, and it's very demanding. It also teaches us and teaches the players to be a patient and to believe going in some specific direction. Analysis is there to bring us the different approach to what we do, to your habits. Because we can talk a lot about the habits, to change it, it's like a therapy, but then 70th minute of the game, the intensity goes higher, your focus, your attention is being more and more distracted. What will your brain do? It will reach for what is already known. Your habit is always known. Your habit, some people have a habit of negative thinking when something goes wrong. And if I'm gonna tell you change it, even though you really want to change it, will you change it? No. So it takes time. You need to acknowledge some specific details. And this is also possible thanks to analysis. But then instead of dwelling on it and trying to change it, hit this point more and more time, you will not change it. You need to create something new. And to create it, you also need analysis to create the point of reference that is actually working more and more possible. It's also important to what I say, how we can call it. Because sometimes the player can tell you, during the analysis, the player can tell you, I knew that will happen. 17th minute, your center back is losing his marker, losing the striker from his field of sight. Opponent goes one-on-one situation and you concede the goal. Will you blame the physical preparation of this player? No. Will you blame the decision-making of this player if he's telling you, I knew it, I knew that will happen? It doesn't make the difference. So it's also, we need to build the habit with the analysis, the habit to anticipate. Anticipation and prediction is not the same. We can predict many things, but when you anticipate, you actually bring your body into the being ready, into the state of presence, ready to react, ready to create. So this is the very long-term.
Can I add something to this, Steve? Yeah. Add something to what Slavomir said, because it's interesting, eh? And I take that as an example of individual training. So when you take football as a starting point, and of course, in those years, expertise comes into the football world. So you have non-football experts entering the football world. On itself, not a problem, but they're coming from a different world. And I heard you say that you take, for example, say physical, but sprinting. The language what they speak and the world where they're coming from, the athletic world, is okay when they have that in that world. But it's a different world than in the football world. So what the football world has to do is look in the other world and bring it back. So when I take the four time and space characteristics, position, moment, direction, speed, and you project this on 100 meter sprint, yeah, then they have to do this. The position is clear. It's that lane. The moment is also clear because there's a starter. The direction is very clear. And the speed is clear, the genes and some training. So, and they have to do that only one time. But in football, sprinting is totally different. It's related to the game situation, to your surrounding and everything. So, but what happened? Yeah, come in our football world and make our players fit. Yeah, that's not the real world. So you have to do that in the football context. And the same, what Flavio said, is also interesting with negative and concentrate. All these words is also that coaches intend to take words from a different world and put it without context in the football world. Because like words like mental, yeah, it doesn't exist. And important is to understand this also. Yeah? When I would ask them, yeah, body and mind, as if there are two different identities. There are no two identities. There's own body. Because when I would ask people, where is the mind then? Is he here? Can I see him? No, it's in your head. Oh, so when it is in my head, but in my head, but outside my body. Yeah, that's already strange. Yeah? So when it is in my head, then it is in my body. And my body interacts with my surrounding. So in my body, in my head, are brains. And with the brains allow me to think. Like lungs allow me to breathe. Like muscles allow me to move. So when you stay thinking, because brains are thinking, and thinking, I translate thinking to think football, think transition, think passing, and have all kinds of football terms. And when it's clear for a player, then you coach football, and you, as a coach, you are a role model. You coach football when you think football. When it's clear for you, you vision. And then players taking over. And when you use the same objective language, then people and players gonna are be able to self-regulating, because they can analyze themselves within the game, in their decision-making execution. And when players gonna self-regulating themselves in decision-making execution, position, moment, direction, speed, then also teams gonna adapt to it. And you get, and you get self-regulating teams, and then you create winning teams. And so to give an example about general terms like physical, mental, or put it back in the football context and related to think football, then you don't use that other word, the other words anymore, because they don't have context. So that's the interesting part, eh? But that's a lot to do.
Of course it is. And I just, when you said that, I recall that very often coaches are telling to the team, we need to run more.
Yeah.
But it doesn't solve anything, because I'm sure every one of us have noticed that, that sometimes when the youth players are entering the certain level, they want to be very overactive. Like they want to be in many places, they run a lot, but in the key moments, they are not in the place where they should be. And yeah, this is something I also faced working with one of the players in the past, that he was over motivated. That in the fact, we worked with the analysis to explain to him that you are doing too much sometimes. So telling you to do something more or less doesn't solve the problem. Like one of the coaches I met, the Portugal under-20 team in last year for the World Cup in Poland, and he told me that it's very interesting that he's telling his team, I don't want you to make everyone 10 or 11 kilometers. You can make 8 kilometers, but you should know when, where, and why you should make make it. So it puts the running into the football thinking as a very, in a very strong connection.
Okay, great.
So yeah, I think Nate has had to leave us at this point, which is a shame. It would have been nice to have got into his thinking on how he puts together his drills when working in a individual one-to-one situation. So I don't know whether Marcel and Slavomir, whether you're able to pick up on that. If there is a moment where you would, I go into isolation, Marcel, I know from hearing you, it's something you would maybe, something you would prefer to avoid, but there are times when, okay, there's going to be a use if I can just go one-to-one.
I missed the first part of your question, Steve.
Yeah, what would be those situations where you would really draw back and think, right, let's take a player out of a group situation and I will just work with him one-to-one?
Yeah.
What would those sort of situations be, and what would it be the sort of drills that you'd be looking to build to kind of, I mean, what is it you achieve from those one-to-ones, I think is probably the main question.
Nate is back. Is the question?
Yeah, sorry, the phone call was quick.
Ah, perfect. So Nate is back. So so the question then was, Nate, yeah, we sort of go into your drills. See, we've done the analysis and we've seen that at Nuremberg you had the sort of the team tactics, the group,
yeah,
and then there's a decision then when we need to like work with this player individually. So once that decision has been made, you have an understanding of what it is you have to work about that.
Yeah.
How, you know, where, what are your influences? Where are you getting the ideas for your drills? Is it very much your, right, let's try and recreate a match situation as much as possible, or are you,
yeah,
working to work that player's specific?
Look, there's no right and wrong way of looking at how to improve one aspect of a player's game. As you could say, there's isolated, you could say with pressure. At the end of the day, I've seen that when a player works on, for example, like his first touch over and over and over again in a certain direction, he has more confidence and then he can do it to have a better first touch in a game. When it comes down to where the training sessions come from, I've been, you know, doing this for a very, very long time. The philosophy that I have is usually it's breaking down from a from another theme that you take into how you want to achieve what you want to achieve. So you always look and you say, okay, I want to work on the player's first touch and that he's moving off of his back foot when he's making a pass. So then you think about a different dynamic movement in a game that you can have for the player that would be sufficient to work on this technical aspect. They're all just things that I've thought up of in the training.
And it's like, but a question that I was bringing with you, Marcel, when you're looking at possibly putting a player out and working on him one-to-one, I mean, what is it you're looking to achieve in that one-to-one moment, which you think you can't do within a group aspect?
Yeah, that's the most simplified format. And it is more, then there's more related to, let me say, when a defender who is big and his body is rough, right? So, and you're talking, the coach also talking, has to go further bending his knee in the one-v-one defending situation when he comes in that situation, because we have to understand that there's no 1v1 in football. Because even when players go alone to the goalkeeper, there's still pressure somewhere from behind or in the front. So but when a defender, and for his feeling, it can be when he bends his knee that he thinks, okay, I'm standing deep for his feeling in his motoric, in his locomotion. But he can do this, and he can do this maybe 60 minutes or 70 minutes. And then you see suddenly that he comes higher and higher in the game. Now, that's a question now when you see this. Is it now a question what we have to discuss with the physical coach? Is it now, let me say, his stamina in his lower back? Another question could be that with a free kick, for example, you see that the player has a natural talent to hit the ball on the right moment with the right swing of his leg, to improve this, to see where can he hit the ball better with the inside upper lace. Because not every player can do this. And it is always interesting to see what is now the strength of a player and make their strength to a super strength, instead to work on some weaknesses, which are you see, we have to pass the ball with left and right. And that's, you can train this for hours, but you will not improve in this. A player, a good player, a talent player, will use it when it is necessary. So this, it is waste of time to put a lot of energy in this, instead improving the strength to a super strength. Because when the muscles are running not in a cross, for the most players, they're running like this instead in a cross. Players who have this in a cross is more easier in the coordination to train this. But it is because it is for them already natural. When you ask them, yeah, I believe I did it in the past already, then when I kicked the ball against the wall, left and right. So it has also always to see in the game situation. Okay, you can train on team level that the right fullback has to pass the ball cross to the midfield player who runs behind. But when he has not this pass, yeah, then you have to bring him often in that situation. And then is the quality of the coaching. How can I improve that passing with him? Because maybe this, that his standing leg is too much far away from the ball. So the moment that he has to kick the ball, his body will go behind him because his center of gravity will be behind him. That means that his arms are busy not to fall down as a way. And that means that the tension of his foot on the ball will also be very low because his body has to correct a lot of other things. Now, when you see this, you can work on him to bring this better, because then his passing will improve, because you need it in the game situation. But that is the last part, as I mentioned before, and that is outside the team training that you can move and do this. The same is that you can talk with a midfield player when you see that he is be able to press the left side, but he's always a little bit too late on the right side. Why is this? And then you see that he has maybe a half pass. He needs a half step more to go in that direction because he is starting maybe with his left leg. It's always interesting when you ask the question, what's your strongest leg? And then players are going to say, my right leg. And you ask him why? Because I can better shoot with this. Now, the funny part is when you throw the ball up and they're heading the ball back, they're jumping with the other leg, with left. So, and then I asked the question again, what's now your strongest leg? You jump higher with this and you shoot better with them, with the white side. What's now? But that's the coordination. So it is a challenge, of course, to say, when you are a striker and there's a cross pass and you are your white leg, 95% jumps with left. So you're jumping with left, you use your arm, so this side is closed and you can heading the ball towards the goal. Now the cross pass is coming from the other side and you're jumping again with your left foot, but this side is open when you have to head in that direction. That's easy for the defender to have one move and you are out of position, you are not stable enough. Then you can ask yourself the question, okay, can we somehow learn him this, that he can do this, when it fits in your plan? Because when you have no wingers, why would you train this? So that are the always the questions. You see all goalkeepers, and I'm not a goalkeeper coach, but I was player by myself, and I walked over the pitch, and I heard the goalkeeper coach in that time saying to the goalkeeper, we're going to now train your weaker side. And I thought, huh, weaker side? So I was watching this, and already in that time I was thinking about things. So, and I asked him, how do you do that? And he was going to shoot him, I don't know how many balls, in that corner. Low, half, high. He said, why would you improve this? Because you see that he needs an extra pass, an extra step extra in that direction. So in the other, let me say, he's better corner. He was always on time, but he could jump with that side of his leg directly in that direction. In the other corner, he needed a half step extra. And this half step extra means that he was a little bit too late. So I said to him, why don't you learn him the coordination that he can jump in that direction also with this leg? Then it will save him time and he's earlier there. Instead of doing a lot of repetitions with shooting, you have to go to the point in detail. And then you can think about it, can we learn him this? Maybe you need another expertise also to strengthen it or to work on the coordination of it. Then you go to the biomechanica. But then you have to make it objective and not based on an opinion. And also ask the question, would it bring something or not? Or is it actually wasted energy?
And Slavomir, I have a question here for you from David Swantak. Now the question is, are there specific principles that are universal, or are they all influenced by the system of play? And then secondly, if they are influenced by the system of play, wouldn't isolated practice be a good starting point?
Actually, there are both. I was working with both specific types of principles. For example, if some new player is joining my team, my club, and I know that the head coach and coaches, we expect some specific types of behaviors from our players in our system of play, then it's also my job to prepare the video analysis that is very relevant to it, that express these specific principles in the specific phases of play, so that in this way the adapting process for the new player is coming more easy and more fluently, and is more, for the most important point, is the more effective. But also, if I work with the players that are not in my team, not in my club, we are using specific principles, let's call it intellectual principles, that are determining point for the intellectual part of the game. And then I call them mostly a tools, because I work with the analysis and the coaching to give my players a specific set of tools that will help him to adapt himself in the specific way, in the specific type of play, and will help them to express themselves on the pitch. We can call it working with the scanning, working with the body orientation, working with the body positioning to get and exploit the spaces that will provide the better perspective for the players to see more. For example, for the center backs, we all know that the center backs are going to perceive the ball and the closest opponent at the same time. If they can see the ball, it's very, very comfortable. It's very comfortable for them, because then they can predict, they can anticipate, and can react better to anticipate to to get the ball away from the opponent. So we're working more on the individual principles specific for position of the player, but also there's principles conditioned by the system of play. If we are working in the 4-1-4-1, and we play with the only one central defensive midfielder, we know that his principles will be quite larger than in the way if we play in the 4-2-3-1 with the double pivot. Then it's being influenced. These principles are being influenced by the system of play. But actually, we are preparing our players more into the direction when they can adapt to both. You know, the more they know, the more they have more tools, they know how to use their tools in a very intelligent way, they are being able to adapt whatever. If we switch from the 4-2-3-1 to 4-1-4-1, they can make it. So that's the point.
Okay, thank you. There's a question here then from Marcel from Mateo Schveliga. Question for Marcel is, what is a group tactic in your opinion, and does it exist at all if football actions are individual and should be consistent with the team context?
Yeah, of course. As I said before, from the highest order is communication. And the tool to train communication is team tactics. So, and based on that communication, players make a decision, and that's based on the game insight, and then they execute that decision. So that explains it already for themselves. And give me an example. Let me say that you have to start the attack and start the attack from a goal kick. And you're going to train this. Now, a better example is the other one. Better example is, let me say that you train the low block pressing. Now, you bring players, six players with a goalkeeper in a low block, and the opponents are eight attackers. Now, you don't going to train the tactical approach to attack those defenders. What you're going to coach, when you have two coaches, for example, you coach the reference. And your reference is low block pressing. So you're defending the goal, low block. That's what you coach. The squeezing and how they move towards each other, when they're going to make the, when they identify the moments of to press. The other coach is coaching the attackers, but not based on the tactical approach, what they have to do. No, that he's coaching the football actions. And football actions in attacking is, for example, passing, controlling, dribbling. That is what he's going to coach. Because attacking is maybe another week. Then you have the tactical approach, how they move towards each other in attacking. Now, and that is where you can compromise. The advantage is that you overload the defenders in order that they learn better defending. And the overload for the attackers is that they that you are able to coach the individual action. Now, that is every football action. And how to get free, how to make a counter movement, the passing on itself, controlling the ball. And it's the same with building up. When you want to build up from a goal kick, and you're playing against an opponent where you know that they're pressing high with two strikers, there's also the question, which type of striker is it? Is it Aguero or is it Peter Crouch? Different types of strikers. But within that given fact, when the what is clear for the players, you're going to zoom in directly on the how. Because when the pass of the, let me say, the center half is with too less speed to the wide fullback, yeah, and the passing line is longer than the line of the opponent to press him, yeah, then you have to pass the ball with a lot of speed so that he has a little bit time to control the ball without directly being pressed. So that is the execution of a football action, what is necessary within the team context. Because when he just passed the ball to pass the ball, yeah, then you give the opponent the reason or the possibility to press the ball and win the ball. So always coaching the detail. And so individual actions are constantly there. So, but you have to identify what's necessary for that moment. So when you are alone as a coach, maybe you have to work first on the what. That's for everyone is clear. What are we going to do when we have the ball, when we're building up, when we lose the ball, when we win the ball? So everything's clear. Once that is very clear for the team, then you can zoom in really on the how, and that's the individual player within the team, and not everything. You can also overload brains to coach everything in general terms, but you don't going to win.
And just on that then, Marcel, there's another question here from Murray Jones pointed towards yourself. And Murray says that he sees a lot of coaching and training in very tight areas, so bringing the systems into tires, where so there's like a high stimulus, lots of transitions.
Yeah.
But maybe the context of the game are unrealistic. Sort of asking, yeah, are we increasing the complexity and stimulus and training outside of the game?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the question is what the coach want to reach with this. When it is not in real areas, then maybe the thought is to create chaos and have some kind of chaos training and train the cognition of players. But you can also train it in real areas. What you often see is that happens in the corner of a pitch. And then you ask yourself, why they are never in the corner of a pitch doing this in the game? So why is it in the corner of the pitch? Why don't you make a real football situation out of it and do it in the real area and create situations with the characteristics of the game and put it inside? But okay, it can be a reason that the coach thinks, okay, in the beginning of the training or maybe a front of training to have some reasons for this, to create chaos training, to wake up the system or whatever. But you can also do that in a football context. And go back to the car. When you're driving a road and you're driving that road constantly every day, everybody knows that road where you're driving. And sometimes you don't realize what you saw on that road. And you do that for weeks and for months and for years in the same road. Nothing is happening. So you do that unconsciously. Till the moment that a deer is running over the road. A deer is running over the road. And suddenly you're driving the same road, but more consciously. So you are much more busy to scan your surrounding because you have that experience. And that experience is now dropped into your hard drive here. Now, and that is what you have to, what I say before, you have to challenge yourself to understand the game, understand yourself, and understand yourself what you want to reach within the in your vision, how you want to play. And then you break it down to training and coaching. And that is why you have to send the stimulus to the players, but always take the real characteristics of the game as a starting point. And of course, there are moments that you can do something else when you, and that is something what you have to, that is experience what you see that the team needs maybe something else to a different period of playing. And when you play a lot of games and suddenly you want to break a little bit the training, I say that the training day to do something totally different, but it's that a different kind of training. So I agree with this tight areas. It's always the question: what do you want to reach with this, and how long do you need it, and why do you do that? Is it pinball, or is it football?
And some of it is just bring it back to sort of the planning of one-to-one sessions or isolated training, as Zubin Javeri says. Is there ever a question that arises about how much of the session should be prescriptive practice and how much would involve individual problem solving situations?
I don't know if I understand the question well.
So when you're planning a one-to-one session or isolated training, is there a question where you come up with a balance of how much of that session should be a prescriptive practice and how much should involve the individual problem-solving situations?
Usually when when there is a chance that I meet individually with the player, as we know now because of Corona, it's not very easy to manage this time distribution very well. We meet in person and we do analysis for 30-35 minutes. Then when we go to the training pitch, we usually work from 45 to 60 minutes. Whether I distribute this work as a reaction time, like waking up the thinking, the reaction time, the recognition of the outer factors, to shorten the time of reaction. And then we go with within the specific scheme, which is a TEA. The first one is to teach, to provide the information to the player through the analysis. And then we execute some specific type of behaviors with the first part of the training. This is the E. And then we go with the A, which is adaptation. So teach, execute, and adapt. And mostly when we work, I was never paying too much attention how much of the time I go to the player individually with the ball. We want to do it as much as possible. But the most important for me is that these touches with the ball, this time with the ball, needs to take place in the specific context that is related to the real game situation. And that is basically related to what we've been talking about within the analysis. Because I work with professionals, they will verify myself if there is something irrelevant that we do. If the player is watching the A on the analysis and then we make a B on the training ground, that the dissonance appear that there is actually something that we are not following in the proper direction. So he needs to experience these touches with the ball, facing problem-solving situations. You make the touch with the ball, okay. But also, what is happening before you get the ball? Are you waiting, standing next to the cone, waiting for me to pass the ball to you? It's a waste of time. You need to be active. When I pass the ball to you, you need to act based on a specific decision-making process. This decision is conditioned to how much do you see in this moment. We try to close everything between the 45 to 60 minutes. It's all connected with the intensity. There is not a word that is 45 minutes without the break, because the recovery, the players are in the main training schedule during the week as well. So we need to be responsible in this matter.
As a follow-up to that, Marcel, again from Zubin, I think the sort of basic question then is, is there scope for creating problem-solving situations in one-to-one training, or by its nature, with one-to-one coaching always going to be prescriptive practice?
There's difference between training and coaching, of course. Huh? Training, then you are 1v1 on a pitch. But is there scope for it? Now, when there is... I call it visualization. When the ability, and that's the ability of yourself as a coach and the ability of the player to visualize the game situation, and then also it has to be quality and not quantity of repetitions. The ability to visualize the game situation. And that's the only thing what you can do in order to improve him, that he learns to learn to solve problems better in the game. But he has to be the ability to visualize it, and or you have to explain it. When you don't see the game situation and understand that, let me say, why does every player on a certain level can touch a ball, can control a ball? Is that the problem? Or is there a different kind of problem? Or a learn moment? And I call it more learning moments, because I don't see problems at players. I see learning moments. You have to realize what's the quality of this player. What is his talent? And are there learning moments also something what he has to learn or he can learn? Sometimes they reach a certain kind of level, and that's their level. And of course, there are things to improve. And when you know the detail of the game situation, but also you have to know something about biomechanica, for example, then you can work with the player individually, but it's not the starting point. And as I mentioned before, this midfield player, and you see that he's a great game inside, he reads the game, but we identify that he is too late sometimes for pressing. So then you can work on the first step principle. Can you do that? Do you identify it? And now you're working together, that you're stepping outside the box, that you're working, for example, or ask an athletic trainer, how can I train the first step principle? Because the muscles are there, because this player obviously running with his flat foot and has not, and doesn't have the coordination to have his first step with his front foot. Now, then you can work isolated with him that he learns this coordination in the first step. You don't make him faster, and it will not interfere because still he has a great game inside. But you give him something extra what can make the difference between this level or this level. But first, you have to understand it. Because when you don't understand it, then it is often training to train. And then everybody thinks and feels, oh, we trained fantastic. But it doesn't give something to improve a player. So there is really a scope, yes, but it has to be in detail related to the individual player. And then ask the question, do we have to work on it? Or is it actually wasted energy? Because we can better work on his strengths and make from their strengths super strengths. And this is an example. This first step principle could be something what you say, okay, we're going to work on this. But that is something what you have to do outside the game and outside the training session. And in the training session, of course, but you, a lot of coaches who are also intended to individual training, maybe you have to be in the staff that you are on field and that you are allowed to coach inside the training session as well with the head coach. Yeah? And then it is based on one or two players what you're coaching at that moment. That makes it much more interesting. And the other things are specific things. And understanding the game. So using, for example, the analysis guys, when you see players who don't understand, for example, the principles of play, although you train it, they don't understand it, but then you're going to see how can we make the theory better, the theory, what they need to apply it on the pitch. And that's again, a different kind of things to identify. So it is very important to have a player review process where you review the players, where are points to work on with this player. And some parts are individual based. Everything is individual based, but other things what we can train individually on certain levels.
I totally agree.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't know, see you nodding a lot in total agreement there. So I don't know if you have anything to add to that before I have a final question for you today.
Oh, I'm open to the final question.
Okay, the final question is
Steve Flauwermeer and all delegates, I have to excuse myself because I have to go now.
Can I ask you this golden question then? A very quick answer on this final golden question. We're going to wrap things up, Marcel, and quite simply there within this training dose, but how are you evaluating? How are you knowing that what you're doing is having an impact on the player? How's that evaluation process going on? It's a golden question, I know, and probably another session all on its own, but if you could quickly summarize how you are doing that yourself.
But the main thing is for yourself, that is interesting. After every training session and after every game, you have to reflect yourself. That's the starting point. When you are not be able to reflect yourself, it is impossible to evaluate others. So first you have to reflect yourself. You have to reflect yourself towards the training session using the reference where you're starting with, because that's your reference and that's a training session. Then you reflect yourself. Okay. And the same for the game. And evaluation is going in line with this. And then you evaluate, did we reach on team level and on individual level the points, the reference, what we wanted to bring to the players. And of course, that is an ongoing process. And evaluation but also on a certain level, not everybody has the ability, but when you have video analysis, how many coaches analyze their training session? Seldom. But when you are taking yourself serious and you have a reference and you create situations to building references also for players, then you have to analyze constantly, what did I train? And a help for this, a tool, is video analysis. So that's also something to use. And it's what is strange that sure in professional clubs, you see it often that it is not used. So you train something, but you don't evaluate it. And that's a process. Because in that evaluation, you have team evaluation, you have individual evaluation. And all kinds of processes are going on in the training session. All kinds of processes going on in the game. And when you do that as a coach, you are a role model. So when you are constantly conscious about yourself and your surrounding, then you can, the player is gonna take that with you. And when it's very clear in which direction you want to gonna play with each other, and the players are in that that concept, and they agree with this and they see it, then in the game situation, is it the same? You're coaching football. You think football, so you think transition, for example. And that's also what you constantly evaluate. Are we in the right process? Because when you don't know what you're doing, you are not be able to evaluate, but you are getting also emotional in games, for example, as an example in between. So the referee has a wrong decision, you're getting emotional. So that allows players that they also get emotional. But when you have a right concept and you're coaching directly, because you can't influence decisions. So when you know that, and it happened in the game, and you're coaching directly transition and organization, players also going to do that. And you're going to evaluate later this kind of things. And so there are all kinds of different kinds of evaluation points what you can evaluate. But it starts with yourself. Are you able to reflect? When you'll not be able to do that, then it is very difficult. Because then evaluation will be only based on, yeah, we were not good today. And Steve, you are in the journalist. How many coaches are coming there and you ask the questions after the game and they're saying, mentally today we were not good. Yeah, sorry, this coach can also talk Chinese. I don't know what he means. Yeah? Or physical, we have to do more. Also something. So, you know, it's a lot. How many coaches blame the players? Blame the players last. You have to reflect yourself and blame yourself first. But that's why you need a whole concept, a universal concept, an idea for yourself. Because when you don't know what you're doing and you don't understand yourself, how would you understand the outside world? And that's why it goes wrong in football often, and then you get emotional coaching and all kinds of terms and all kinds of words without any context. And then you expect from players that they can evaluate themselves. Now, come on, it's not possible. And when it is a clear objective, and what I tried to show you, this football action language, with position, moment, direction, speed, and when players understand the communication level, they understand how they can improve in their decision-making and the execution, and they can analyze themselves in position, moment, direction, speed. There's a process, yes, but when you coach them in that process, they're going to take that over, and then you get self-regulating players. And then the evaluation will be totally different. It is always interesting to see that when you have then a video meeting and you're going to discuss with an individual player or with a team, you have a totally different conference. Suddenly they are involved and there's really something going on. And so that's a process. This question is good because there's a process what brings everything together, because that shows also that football has a lot to win.
Yeah. And also, finally, then, Slavomir, that's the same golden question for yourself.
Well, I'm going to put it very shortly because in a big process, Marcel, yeah, you need to leave. So I see you. You want to say something, so please.
Yeah, I have to leave because I have a phone call with two Bundesliga coaches who played yesterday the top game, and they want to evaluate. So they want to evaluate, Steve. So sorry, I have to go. I have to make this call with those two because it was already 5 minutes over time. So I probably get a yellow card from them. So
okay, before it gets into the second yellow.
yeah, that's red, then I'm out. Okay, thank you very much. Good job, all. And, okay, see you. Bye bye.
Bye bye. All right, Steve. So I will put it very, very simple. Because I totally agree with what Marcel has said. Let's maintain the most important factors. First of all, maintain your identity, keep it clear, and maintain your culture of work, because that's what has a very big influence on your players, to have the identity and the culture. And analyze on a regular basis. And that's what Marcel also said. I will just reply that evaluate yourself as a coach, be the role model, and then we can all maintain in the same way and maintain the same principles. And that's how we can build a stable long-term process. And that's very difficult because sometimes the environment of football is bringing a lot of changes the management of the team, sometimes the politics in the Eastern countries. We all are being in the under the many points of influence. So if we can maintain this, sooner or later, it will bring the effect for everyone.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Thanks a lot, Slavomir. And thanks a lot to everyone out there who's joined us today with their questions. And it's just time now to wish everyone a great Christmas. And we'll see you all in 2021 on the Sunday session.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Steve. Once again, we are in touch on the phone in the case of there will be anything we can talk about further. So it was a great pleasure for me to be here. And thank you once again.